unheard conversation between Krishna and Abhimanyu before they go into battle. Hello friends, welcome to my channel All Things Spiritual. Today we will look at a dialogue between Sri Krishna and Abhimanyu, which I could consider as a small trailer of the vast Bhagavad Gita, a minuscule knowledge of which was imparted to Abhimanyu. Abhimanyu, as you know, is a legendary warrior from the ancient epic the Mahabharata. He was born to the third Pandava prince Arjuna and the Yadava princess Subhadra, who was also Krishna's sister. He is believed to be an incarnation of the Varchas, the son of Chandra. Abhimanyu was raised by his maternal relatives, as his father Arjuna along with his four brothers and wife were sent to Vanvas for 13 years. After his father's return, Abhimanyu married Uttara, the princess of Matsya. During the Kurukshetra war, Abhimanyu fought by his father's side. On the 13th day of the war, the mightiest Kaurava warriors came together and formed a Chakravyuh. The young Abhimanyu was able to penetrate through it, but could never make his way out of it, and was slain inside it, fighting all alone. His son Parikshit saved the lineage from extinction and went on to become a legendary king. The conversation that I am talking about happened days before Abhimanyu entered the Chakravyuh. Krishna tells Abhimanyu that the person has no regard for his own Atman, and in case of calamities and adversities only does man look for God or tries to visualize God. Such a person is unable to face challenges of his own life, and such a person lives a life of a commoner. Such a commoner has no face to show in case of adversities. Krishna tells Abhimanyu that look at these soldiers. History won't be remembering these soldiers. They are all commoners. They also can be struck by death suddenly. And as you are human too, you could also die in this war. Hearing these words, Abhimanyu's face expression suddenly changes. His face shows fluster and confusion as to why Krishna mentioned death in this regard. Krishna continues, each death has its own significance. Crores or innumerable number of people would die in this war. But in a sense, they won't really die, as the Atma is always undying, and the people dying won't achieve fame and honor of dying in the war. This is defined in the destiny that each person carries when he or she takes birth. As a side note, Sai Baba had so many ill wishers, and where did those people that insulted him go? They all drowned into darkness. Did they achieve fame at all in their lives? Baba's name is just enough to expel the darkness that they left behind them. As another example, in Shivaji's time, a lot of people died, but Tanaji gets a special reference, mind you. Historically, he got glorified. Had he come alive from the conquest of the fort of Gondana, he would not have any name in the history books at all. The main reason he achieved fame was because he achieved martyrdom fighting over the recapture of the fort of Gondana after the truce broke down between the Marathas and the Mughal Empire in 1617. So coming back, as Sri Krishna continues, and he states that death comes to everyone, and even though you are a teenager, the elders are more worried about you, and I hope you are not as worried as they are, right? Hearing this, Abhimanyu was even more baffled as to what Krishna was trying to convey to him. He gave him a look as though he wanted to know what he was trying to say to him. Krishna continues, would you like to have had Dhritarashtra's age? Abhimanyu's face then drops with embarrassment. Krishna told Abhimanyu, dying at a ripe old age makes no difference. Example, when a family member dies, there is a sorrow and the family misses the departed one. But this sense of loss is rooted in the attachment to the form only, which is independent of the soul. It is the form which has vanished, and it is not the soul. The soul is not dead in its true nature. It did not even pass away, for it is everywhere. But through attachment to the body, the form is considered important, and all the desires and emotions and thoughts that were centered upon the form, when they go through death and the form disappears, there is a vacuum which expresses itself through the missing or the departed one. So even if the family suffers an agonizing pain of the departed, the Atman has no sorrow attached to it. You do your prescribed duties as the part of the war, and whatever lifespan you have been given, fame is now intertwined with it. An example of how fame gets intertwined with the destiny of a person could be rightfully pointed out with the life of Swami Vivekananda and his spiritual accomplishments. And they were many, and his fame went viral considering it was a century prior, and there were many yogis that were jealous of Vivekananda's fame and they couldn't even come close to the fame that Vivekananda achieved. Notice that I mentioned yogis, and you would think yogis would have achieved some distinction in their life, but there are still some that need more time in their own individual evolution. Krishna then tells Abhimanyu that your father, your mother, friends and colleagues and close relatives are just there for this one lifetime. Your real relation is with Sri Hari or God. The Jiva is the Shiva's impure form only. Once the ignorance is vanquished, he or she is Shiva only. The Jiva's ignorance and his non-Atman point of view towards life, unless he turns towards his Atma, he won't understand what the essence of Shiva is. Abhimanyu didn't understand Krishna's words. He was sharp in the worldly knowledge, but he hadn't a knowledge about the Atman. Krishna then told him that it's okay if you hadn't understood this, but there will come a time when you will definitely understand these words. So fast forward to the present day, all this was being recalled by Abhimanyu as the bow pierced through his throat, and it was painful. And he remembered this conversation with Sri Krishna, and remembering the conversation, he felt very satisfied and peaceful. As the bow was shot unto him, his life force wasn't retracted from his body immediately. It took some time, and all this conversation with Krishna came back to him at that particular point of time of his death. And when he came out of his body, he saw his own body, and there was a view of duality that he saw right in front of him. And he got what Sri Krishna was then trying to say to him, that the Atman never dies. And I see my own body lying in the war zone, and I see people dancing at one end, and the other end the people were lamenting in sorrow, which were the Pandavas. Abhimanyu's soul then told itself that this is all just transitory. Sri Krishna then told the truth, and he knew that what is true was the Atman only. And I am full of happiness now within me. Where is my pain now? And the body was just like an outer clothing. The pain was only to my outer variables. I am forever indestructible. And he saw Uttara crying. And he had absolutely no feelings at that point while seeing her cry. It was just their own destiny to observe sorrow by the passing of their loved one. Ishwara and me are the only truth, and he is there, which is Sri Krishna. He is God, and we are all his attendants. I am in no position right now to tell them not to cry, O Uttara. And so with this being said, God took him to an onward journey, and his whole life journey was really fruitful. After hearing about the death of Abhimanyu, Sri Krishna got off his chariot, and the Pandavas were crying, Uttara was crying, Draupadi was crying, and Arjuna then said to Krishna that you have taught me a lot about the Atman, which he was referring to the Gita, the knowledge of which was imparted to him at the start of the Kurukshetra war. So he told Krishna that you gave me the knowledge of the Atman, and I do feel bad, but I am able to control myself. But what about these people that are lamenting now? Yudhishthir, being a Jnani, is also crying. Sri Krishna said, don't worry, I will try and console them. Sri Krishna then asked Yudhishthira, so many people died in front of you, and at that time, why didn't you cry? People are dying in the war, left, right and center, and there is a frantic loss of life in this war, and you feel sad only when someone is related to you. And he told Yudhishthira, your soldiers, your commanders have died, and you didn't even have time to look in their direction. So the only thing you differentiate is because the individuality that you carry within you, and that's why you cry. The consciousness in all of them was only one, isn't it? Even though man is individualized in his own body, but the fabric of consciousness underneath is only one. So today you may be feeling bad, even though Abhimanyu died a martyr and he has accomplished what he was here to do. Draupadi mentioned that it's not like that, Krishna. Look at Uttara. She has a baby in her womb. And what about that baby? Sri Krishna then said, this is the plan of Sri Hari or God only. Observing sorrow is an insult to God. He then told to Draupadi that even though a man dies, his underlying consciousness never dies. And since the consciousness never dies, a jnani or a wise man never observes sorrow. And only the ones that are stuck in Maya observe sorrow. Hearing this, Yudhishthir immediately stopped. Sahadev's expression was quite different from the rest, and he was accompanying the people in their sorrow, but he was like a reclusive yogi. Sri Krishna then tells Draupadi, it was you that wanted revenge, right? Revenge just burns the parties that are involved in it. Don't you have to pay the price for this? The Pandavas are going to be alive at the end of this war. Shouldn't that mean there should be some sacrifice at least? You wanted revenge and this is the price you have to pay. Draupadi replied, no Krishna, Abhimanyu was very young, don't you think? Krishna laughed and he said that this is your ignorance only, Draupadi. Does the Atman have an age? It was the age of the body only. Although his destiny was already decided as he took birth and the fame that he has received would never end. On a side note, people still name their children Abhimanyu to this day and age. So coming back, Krishna then says, observing sorrow for a departed person is a total disregard for that person's life on earth, as everything happened as per the wishes of God only. His death in the war was absolutely certain, and the person that comes to birth inherits the boon or a blessing of death also. Do not look in sorrow due to the lifespan of the departed, and that lifespan is of no use if you think about Dhritarashtra, isn't it? And all these dead people in the war, don't they have one consciousness? And when you think about it, when you see your own relations, you get tears in your eyes. And think about the soldiers as they come from homes that have families too. The death therefore doesn't happen in the real sense. God is indestructible and the Jiva is the gross form of Ishvara or God only. And he has different forms and names. And this is an outer differentiation or a boundary between people. Due to Maya only, the God appears in two forms, Prakriti and Purusha. Nature is Prakriti only. And the nature is ever changing and is transient. And from that meaning, it is not everlasting. Leaves are going to turn yellow and then into dust one day. Nature has to go through the three gunas of creation, maintenance and destruction, or Rajas, Sattva and Tamas. That which is created